Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Typically, we find a lot of them, but not at the same level that you would find the men. I haven't seen the audience. I mean, I think there's about three women in the audience. So we brought on board Chitra Ravi. Now, she's a very, very inspirational woman. Give you a quick background about her before we start on. So she has had a very varied career. She's been in banking, she's been in real estate, she's been in modeling, she's even been offered film roles. Right? And
decades ago.
So then I think she took a break to, you know, have a family, and after, actually very, very inspiringly, she, after having two children and after the children grew up, she started EZ Vidya. And today EZ Vidya is now across India, and I think they're also having an international presence. And they've been awarded very recently the Economic Times Game Changer Awards. And she's been recognized widely as one of the leading women entrepreneurs in the country. So, can you give her a warm startup brand welcome? So, that's it for coming on board. So, like I was telling you, so this is going to be a very interactive Q&A, very, very interactive session. So, why don't you start by giving us a little bit of background of your own, in your own words, and then talk a little bit about how you got into entrepreneurship.
Sure. So good morning to all of you. I think Sriram has given a good background, but what struck me also was, like in any business meetings, any conferences I go, I search and look out for women both in the audience and the panel. So I don't think the country has changed so much from when I started a decade ago. And I particularly feel responsible for that also. I mean, when I started, just to, say the first 5 years, I was very careful that we should be a majority women employee organization. But today I have to say we are like 60-40. Any guesses on what the 60 is and what the 40 is?
60.
Yeah. So at some point I realized that I shouldn't be so much carried away by this women-centric approach. But that doesn't mean my my penchant, my passion to see women in business, women as entrepreneurs, women as seekers. It's not just that you have to succeed. Women seeking. It hasn't died, but I think I'm just changing the way I could do it. Because to even influence, even to be a force that can carry this, I need to first succeed as an entrepreneur, and that's what I'm aspiring to do. So I think pretty much an introduction has been given by Sridhar, but it is true that this bug to start something on my own came with my two children. I saw them, as I normally say, I saw them walking to school, running back home, and I'm very forcefully and fiercefully a person who does not believe in thank God it's Friday. I would like the world screaming thank God it's sunrise. You know, it's not about Monday or Friday. So when I saw that they were looking forward to weekend because they may not be in school, looking forward to holidays, I said there should be something not so right about this system. And so I had two choices, either to complain, either to say that somebody has to do something about it. I could blame the teachers, I could blame the school, I could blame the CBSE board, I could blame the Indian educational policies, or I could do something about it. And I'm so thankful that something struck me, that I started with nothing, with just a few people. I mean, I have a colleague here, Ganesh, few people who just said, yeah, we also believe in this movement that we can do. And that's where we are, and I must say it's been a very exciting journey. So I don't know if I had not had my family and my two children, I would have done what I have done today. So it's not like, you know, I did that and then chose to be an entrepreneur. So I would say my first buck wasn't to be an entrepreneur, was to make a difference, was to endeavor to see if I can do something about something I feel so strongly about, and that is a personal experience. So then came, actually entrepreneurship, then came the finances that go with it, then came success factors, then today we are in the scale bug. So that is a journey for any entrepreneur. But I think what perhaps from my own experience and many experiences of people that I'm closely associated with, entrepreneurship should not just be, I want to be an entrepreneur. It should be, I want to make a difference. I want to do something about something that I truly care about. And then entrepreneurship is the best possible avenue for that. And that's what I would say of my background. But if you particularly want me to talk about anything.
So obviously you've done it the other way than what most people would do, in the sense you got inspired because you saw your children having a bad time in school, okay? At least the education sense, right? So you started off doing this. But how easy or how difficult was it for you to start off? Because obviously, from what I understand as a male, is that once a woman is at home and taking care of the family, it's very difficult for them to get back with the job side. Especially starting off something on their own. In our patriarchal society, it's very difficult for a woman to break in and say, close schools and talk to a principal. No, I'm not doing this. So how was that?
Yeah, so though it may seemingly be relevant to the majority audience, I think it's absolutely relevant to all of you that I speak a little about being a woman entrepreneur. I completely agree with Sriram, and if you look at my background, I have not been a teacher. I do not have a B.Ed. Or a tag until possibly 5 years after I started. I took a stint in Harvard Grad School of Education just to have this in my resume. You know, and I felt that it makes a whole lot of difference. Though my daughter say that, you know, you have to acknowledge it was only a short-term stint, you know, don't go about saying, and I'm very careful not to mislead. But it does make a big difference, and personally it made a big difference to me when I was there. First of all, to think that many of the ideas present in my conscious and subconscious mind and in a team that I work with is very much what a research-backed Harvard grad school also says. You know? So it was very difficult. So there are two things to it. One is being a woman, and there's a whole family behind you to say very empathetically, very sympathetically, it's okay if you fail. They would never say that to a male, right? For me, it was always the very understanding, supportive family within quotes was constantly telling me, oh, it's okay, relax, you don't have to worry, you have a breadwinner, you're not doing this for money. So I want women to be very careful about these things, you know. These things may seemingly be very, very supportive reactions, but to me it wasn't. I would rather my male counterpart and male figures in my family, I don't have a son, so you know, maybe my father-in-law, my husband, to come and tell me, go rock the world, you know. But it was always, don't worry, you have some backup at home, so it's okay. They would wait for me to say, I'm so tired today, okay, do you want to change, do you want to quit? And I would have my husband saying, do you want to join me again? I think we can do a whole lot of things together. But, so these are things that I think are very annoying for women. But most of the time, I find that women take this as a consolation, a support, and then they go back. They lean out, to use Sheryl Sandberg's term. You know, for me, it was constantly fighting this, and I'm talking about the non-client stakeholders in my entrepreneurial journey. On the other side, or the stakeholders that truly matter, the clients, who would also ask me questions like, okay, so what are you trying to do? You are, you've never taught. What is your experience? And so, and when we entered, it was a time when schools were so within themselves. You know, they would think that we have all the expertise. The outsourcing was a very, very conflicting, contradictory terminology for them. They would even not understand, why would you give me something that I'm supposed to be an expert in? So all these, I think, made my personality evolve very hard, you know, meaning I had to really build in a super confidence in myself. So all the steps I took were to just tell myself that I have to become what I believe in. And there are a lot of people in different ways trying to move me away from that. So I would say an entrepreneurial journey, especially for a woman with no great experience, it's a whole lot of, it's a big difference if a guy who's perhaps has a professional qualification behind him, maybe a Sri Ram, or someone who's, you know, out of an IIT, IIM. Today IIT, IIM also have different kinds of people in the political scene. But, you know, you come out and you say, I want to start up. The world, the way the world looks at you is very different from a woman, educated, but not so much a professional, a homemaker turned entrepreneur. The way you are looked at and the way this other guy is looked at is absolutely different. Even the support is very condescending for us, whereas it's very uplifting for the other. So this is what I want to say here. So the outlook you need will be completely different. It's taken a very long time for me to, today when people don't really ask me, are you out of a big B school, or are you out of, you know, have you had educational experience? Now they wouldn't dare to ask me because of the success of the organization. But it's been constantly there. So to do your thing, to focus on the business, the domain, and also handle these, I think has been the extra pain for maybe people like me.
So how did you actually start off? So you started off with a computer training center and then got into this. So how did you start off and how did you get your first grade game?
So I don't know if it's just to add glamour to my resume that I can say it was a garage startup, but it was literally that. I just, all the support I needed was my people to say you can refurbish the garage and do something. I wanted to first get a feel of can I do what I think I can do, and that is inspire kids. And literally when I started this learning center with some multimedia equipment and, you know, I experimented, I could see the kids were actually running to my little school. So I think that gave immense confidence because that was the shackle I was trying to break with my kids as well. You know, they would look forward to the class and it was like weekly couple of hours class, and parents would come and ask me, you know, I think my kids are so enjoying being here, why don't you start a school yourself? So I knew I was getting in that direction. So that was a very tiny start that I had. And then there came a time when I had to literally choose between two roads of, should I start a school? It will be much easier for the world to accept that, in my own small world as well. Or should I go out in the world and do something? And I thought well over it for a period of time, and I'm so thankful that I took the decision, because if it had been a school, I would have had immense satisfaction, but my influence would have been so much more limited. But today we work with over 1,000 schools in the country, over several government schools, which again is a very pet passion for us in terms of, you know, because they are the real people of India. That may not have happened. So it's a choice in retrospect that I think was a very bright, very sound choice that I made. So that was the humble beginnings.
Okay.
I think the initial success factors that made us think that we are in this game for good was the response and initial qualitative indicators we got from the schools that we worked with, from clients, and we felt that we were there. And so slowly the intent was working in execution as well, started coming to life.
So how do you do the shift from big computer training for children, which obviously will be nascent because that my company is itself nascent, to getting into now the curriculum and so many other facets of education? It's a big change in terms of expansion and all. So what brought that on and what was your first big thing?
So as you're asking this question, I see that there has been two facets of EZ Vidya, and I won't anymore say it's me because it's us, our big team today. We, I think, have two facets. One is being proactive and one is being responsive. And I think we need to be both. I'll tell you why. Because most of the next steps in terms of business has been a responsive approach. I'll come to the proactive bit. Responsive approach because, like I said, my humble beginning, and then when we saw that it was working, and when I saw that people were asking, why can't you start a school, why can't you go to schools with this kind of a methodology, we responded. We responded quickly, we started, going to schools. There began our journey. And then one of computer education was a big hit. And hitherto, I don't know if you all know, in schools, which subject teachers do you think are considered the Rajnikants? The style statement people or, the more popular ones. Any idea?
Science, math.
The very core stuff. Maybe an English teacher who would influence. But then, mostly for the children, math mattered, right? Or science mattered. So you'll always have this math teacher, and it's big between the walls. I can't dare say this to schools. So they would be the real kings and queens, and flashing. And the most disrespected, for want of a better word, would be the computer teachers. It's just another subject. Or, I'll choose computer science because I can get a 200 out of 200. I don't really care what I'm learning there. That kind of a model. But suddenly, when we went with our curriculum for computer teachers, which had a very unique approach, which had children running. See, children would even then run, even before we came, and would run to the computer labs. You know why?
Yes.
AC. How you like to go to the playground for a PT class, you also like to go once a week to the computer class because Abba AC is there. But otherwise, you really didn't respect your computer teacher. I mean, I can see a lot of young faces, so you can relate to it. So, after we went, we started realizing that, in fact, to quote one of the math teachers, she said, "What magic do you have in your materials? We have a book that we give, and it could pass off as another textbook, but when you go in, you really see what is in it." She said, "You know what? I use it as a bait for my children to finish their math problems. I tell them, if you finish that, you can go to your ICT studio. We call it the studio, your chrysalis studio, and you can work on it." So I would see the children are finishing faster. So there came demands or requests from these teachers saying, "Why don't you do something about our own subjects, for an English, for a math? Because I see that the children are so besotted with your approach." So again, we were responsive and we said, "Okay, now I think we are ready to launch chrysalis in other subjects as well." So that's why I'm calling us responsive. And today again, we are responsive because international waters are beckoning. They are telling, "Why don't you come and do things here?" I say we are proactive because if you look at the methodology that we bring in, the innovative approach to learning we bring in, I still think we are years ahead of the current situation. It's sometimes also our disadvantage. It's like a Kamal Hassan movie, right? We say it's awesome, but box office, we are not too sure. So I think that way we are proactive. And so I would say we are at once responsive and proactive. So if you look at our business journey, largely we've been responsive. I don't know if it is more than just being the nudge. It could even be within our entrepreneurial risk approach. It could also mean we'll wait and see if this will work. But it could also mean that we want to give the market what it deserves when it's ready. So you can look at it, in several ways. But my sharing here for you all will be learning is be at once proactive and responsive. You can't see if we are totally responsive. I don't think you need methodologies. Today we are going to come out in the next 6 months. It's in our boardroom right now, and it should be released in the next 6 months. What's going to storm away the school market with something incredibly meaningful and 21st century looking. So that's happening in the R&D constantly. So that's the proactive part. But also we need to listen to the market. We need to be responding to their needs. So you can't be totally throwing something that the market is not ready yet. So I think these two have to go hand in hand.
Being this, obviously you need to have a good team to support you, because once you get in from just computer education, you need so many subjects. You need to have experts in each team, you need to work. So how do you scale from, I think, being a small one or two people organization over the last decade to scale that whole number? Like over 150 people. So how did that happen? How are you able to attract the top talent?
This domain is very unique because the first thing one needs is have a very passionate person who feels and cares about something. I won't even say just education. Somebody who cares about society, who cares about the environment, who cares about human rights. Today we're going to again be working in human rights education as well. So it just occurs to me that I should talk about it. All these need simply care and sensitivity. So our top talent, if you were to say, or what we look for in people is just this. Yeah, you need hard skills, you need knowledge, you need several things. But the first thing is you need to be caring. You need to be thinking about something. And you should, that is very important. So it's not at all easy to get people. I can, otherwise maybe it would have been even a bigger organization today. It's very difficult because we are constantly talking and deliberating inside about this movement. It's for all practical reasons. In fact, sometimes when people call me a social entrepreneur, you know, we've got some awards and all that as social entrepreneur. I have my own discussions with my colleagues on, I don't know, what is this word, you know? I don't know, an entrepreneur is an entrepreneur. Social entrepreneur, there's still no great definition, okay, in that space. People are still not clear whether what it is. But to me, every entrepreneur is sustainability comes only if he's a social entrepreneur. So I think I'm getting diverted there. But what I want to say here is, people are the most important in things like this, because you're not dependent on machines. You're not, your bet is on the brains. Everything comes from creativity, from innovation, from thinking, from caring, sensitivity. So it's been very, very difficult for us. But I would say that constant looking out and no rigidity in our recruitment. It's very difficult. You go to HR or you go to someone and ask them, they say, can you give me a JD? I say, it's very difficult to get a JD for what we are doing, right? It's not yet there, at least until now, it's been very difficult to do that. So being open, taking a lot of time to meet people who are interested has been the focus of many of us in EZVidya. So we meet a lot of people and explore. And I also wanted to break the myth over a period of time that if you want money, go to IT companies. If you are okay with, you know, whatever, and you care for something, then come to a company like EZVidya. It was, very honestly, my pitch in the first 5 years. I would meet a person and say, hey, you have some technical background, no? So if you want to really make money and all that, don't come here. But if you want fulfillment, if you want all the other things, come to us. And then I told myself, I'm doing the wrong thing. I'm actually giving this generation, this the youth of today, a very strong statement that good work will not be monetarily rewarded. And I think that's something that I've done in the early years of EZVidya. But I think from 2006-2007, the whole pitch for us changed. And I can tell you, when that pitch changed, we are also today seeing profitability. We are also today seeing growth in revenues, in top line, in bottom line. And we are also seeing that many of our people are earning very well. So I think an entrepreneur's mindset or belief system is very important to create an enterprise. If I believe in something, I'm going to give that to the people. So the first 5-6 years, it was always the safety pitch, which I would say, it's more caring, it's more good work, come, let's work together. You may not get the money, but today I see my language changing. I can, in the next 5 years, tell you that we could be one of the best paying companies in our domain. So, and it doesn't mean that you have to sell televisions to schools. No, that's the difference, right? In our company, we don't sell tangible assets to schools. Whereas most educational companies listed in stocks today are companies that sell tangible. Their clients are the same clients as mine, but what they sell and what we sell are so different. So I think the time has come that we don't have to worry about tangibility in at least the Indian scenario. And we are, I think, contributing immensely to make this comprehensible and perceivable by schools. I think every day our salesmen are going and telling them, because we've had experiences, Sriram, we would have a very well-researched studio, and we've had schools that has a book vendor in charge who will carry another book on the right hand, carry our book on the left hand and say, "Idhu romba lighta irukke madam, but you're charging double." You know, that's the day when you feel like, hello. So the brain power is very difficult for people to imagine and give an attribute of value to. But I think things are changing in that, and I think we have contributed, at least in our ecosystem, we have contributed immensely to bring this change in the very small world that we interact with.
Now, because you're talking about retaining of talent, having such good people on board, and because all your work, like you said, is not tangible, it's all brain work that goes in, how do you make sure that the quality goes in? Because unlike IT companies, which are selling a service, it's not only impact lives of so many children. So, how do you, because obviously you can't personally, or your company cannot personally check everything that goes in.
Yeah.
So, what kind of quality controls do you have?
So, apart from the people, apart from a fantastic product, I think the focus in the last 2-3 years is also to bring visibility and tangibility to something that is believed is immeasurable. I think that's been the focus of people in the top management of EZVidya, where we said that who said you can't say. See, until then it was an acceptance, like, you know, education, you will know the rewards only after 10 years. You know, primary education, how can you go tell somebody that your child will think better? How do you measure thinking? How do you measure creativity? But I think one of the biggest things that's happened in EZVidya in the past few years is we have found methods to bring tangibility and even a physicality to something that is believed is immeasurable. So today we have schools coming even at the end of 6 months of experiencing with us saying, "I think it's making a world of difference to our children." I see that teachers who said there was a backbencher, today we see that guy is participating the most. That guy is performing better, and teachers have cried to us saying, you know, "I think I didn't know this potential at all." So, or even students believing in themselves, finding opportunities. It's coming to life. So I think that's the key thing that we have to, you know, bring in. And there are processes, there are information systems, there are graphs, which is all, you know, analytics that we are trying to crack to make this more and more tangible. And I think it's very important. I'm very honest here saying 5 years back, the same interview would have been different. I would have said it's very difficult to measure things in education. You know, how things change when you start believing you have to do some things that... So now we are trying to see how we can. It's not like we've cracked it all, but we are very much in that direction, which I think is going to be very critical for success as an enterprise. Otherwise, good work can just go under the sea. I know many companies that do phenomenal work, but they are not able to see. Ultimately, we need to make ourselves visible and tangible. So I think that is something that's very recent in EZVidya, and we are already seeing the results.
And in the early days where, you know, you were the face of the company, it was probably the one where they come to you, all the companies are saying to them. But today, where probably most of the clients don't even meet you, but your marketing team, how is that come about. That would have obviously taken some time to train up the people, and also change the customer mindset that they have to come to you for it.
Absolutely. Today, if you ask many clients, they would say that there is a common thread with all the EZVians we meet. We call ourselves EZVians, and they say, how is it we see that there is so much common? And one commonality, when we did a survey of this a few years ago, and we said, what do you think is one commonality? And they said the smile. So I think it is something that just gets into the culture of the organization. So one thing we've also focused, even when we were small, is on the culture aspect. You know, it's only large companies that think that I have to get into HR initiatives, I have to get into culture initiatives. That's another myth I want to really bust here, that start working on the culture thinking that you are a big company. Otherwise, there have been people who've told me when we talk about culture deliberations, when we were just 30 people, 35 people, they would say, what? Yeah, I mean, you're still too small to think about all this. But all these has worked for us now, because I feel that if we had not worked on it then, we would not have a culture today. And there is a very distinct culture. And of course, I should not disregard or not mention certain tools that we have come up with that brands us, whoever takes it. But I have to be honest, it's not like what I convey is something equal to what a new salesman conveys. I don't think we are yet there. It's not process proof, right? So there will be differences. There have been times when clients see a talk of me on television and then go back and say, I want to meet her because I didn't know this was there, or this is what EZVidya is all about. There are gaps. We are not living in a fool's paradise to think everything is, you know, hunky-dory. But I think somewhere we have got the tools and prepared ourselves to see that the dilution is not at least polaristic. It can be weaker, it can be more diluted, but it should not throw something that is not us. So I think that's what one has to be careful. It's not that everybody clones. And that's something we had a very interesting initiative in the last few months, where we tried to identify what we called as 14 members of EZVidya. About 15 people came to the finals, and then we are now selecting 8 people out of that, so that they are part of the management's strategic discussions, etc. So we had external panelists, experts come and interview these people from different departments, but yet they were all so unique in their own way. So that's exactly what we want to do in schools. A teacher, I mean, you say I come out of the school, you have a certain, you can make guesses, right? Are you from Vidya Mandir? Are you from Lady Andal? Are you from... But yet, it's not that we all churn out a set of clones out of the school. We need individuals with their own uniqueness. And that's not happening today. So that's been our philosophy even in education, self-discovery through schooling. And so, all the more responsibility on us, the management, that we have the same thing in the organization. We need to foster individuality, because we believe that everyone is intelligent. I know some lessons are driven hard by my kids about when I started. There is this big theory called multiple intelligence that we also take in our approach, which is everybody is intelligent. It's not how much intelligent you are, it's what intelligence you have. So I used to talk about this to my kids as well. And in one of the phone calls, apparently I used the word loosely, saying, I don't think he's not intelligent. So I had my daughter, who was much younger then, coming and telling me, you have told me that everyone is intelligent, and how can you talk about a colleague that way? So this is a lesson we tell ourselves, that, you know, there is uniqueness, yet there is... So these are some of the mantras in our people empowerment. And that is why I think we have a very charged up, very motivated team of people.
You started doing your, all this, the team building, the culture of the company, everything from a very early day, so that the new employees get into the culture, so that is what changeability is.
Absolutely. And I'm telling this because most entrepreneurs will be advised by consultants, by people, by board to say all that can wait. You first get your P&L right. You first get your product right. I'm not saying one should not, but according to me, there should be equitable focus. Otherwise, you can't wait for, okay, I'll achieve this turnover, then start focusing. It's not going to work that way. Absolutely. Then you will be going and working on certain fundamentals. You'll be going to the foundation and say, yeah, now we've achieved this turnover, this profitability, but we have to now invest. And your investment then could be many times more. So I think that's a huge learning for me. And I would like to share it in every forum that I go, that, you know, sometimes just listen to the consultants, don't obey them.
So, coming to how you scale them in terms of business. Now, at least in India, a lot of schools are politically connected. Colleges for sure, but schools also are to a point. Government schools, you don't need to ask. So, how do you, break that barrier? Because there will be a lot of challenges there. So, how, what happens there?
I don't know what challenges you're talking about. Is it interference of...
No, I'm just generally saying, because school is very politically connected. So it's not very easy breaking it, because they'll have their own set of people doing it, who will be in the politicians related and so on. So as you change the mindset and going and say, listen, because you're going based on product, not based on a relationship. So you're going to say, listen, my content is better than anybody else, and you can do something that's going to benefit the student. But is the reception from the teachers, from the principals, as good as you would expect it, or you have to work on them for a long gestation?
Until 2 years ago, I would say most of my energies went there. You are right, because I wouldn't even talk about political connections. I would just talk about wrong prioritization. You would see a school with bad toilets investing in fantastic audiovisual equipments in the classroom, which is very sad. For me, it's like, you know, basic hygiene aspects. You would invest in AC classrooms and not have a single rupee budget for teacher training. But this has changed over a period of time. We are seeing that there is more awareness. But right, as you rightly said, it's very frustrating. It has been extremely demotivating when you go and see that they don't see a point. I mean, it's not about buying or not buying your product. That happens in everything, you know. But even listening, recognizing that this is important, that, I mean, we'd be very glad if there is competition of similar nature. But when your competition is a publisher who is given 150 pages of nothing, and they say that, you know what, we get 30% kickback, or he's sending us to Japan, he's sending us to whatever, that is when your frustration is all the more. If they're comparing the product to product, then we have a forum, you know, we have a ready audience to cater to. So these are, I'm still not saying it's all gone, but I think certain, and I would top rate parental awareness, social media, and other aspects as the reason for this. But long way to go though. That's why I say entrepreneurship, at least in my experience, is about morning to evening resilience. I think it is not resilience on a bad year or, you know, bad takeoff of a product. It's every day. Because every day there is a good customer who and I don't say a good customer is the one who buys. Not so according to me. A good customer who's got his ideology and his philosophy to bring the best for the learner. And then you have every right to say, I don't find that in your product. Fine. I mean, that's what you are. It's not like if he buys, he's a good customer. I still have, according to me, not so great customers who are paying me every year. Because it's they bought it for something else. They have bought it to perhaps a showcase. And that's equally hard for me, even though I get a check from them every year. And so our attempt is to change and make them see the product. So when you are selling intangibility, it is even more important that there is a sink in the ideology, right? It's not about you looking at it and saying the book is nice. sometimes I say that, you know, what do you like about the product? They will look, the wrapper is so beautiful. I mean, then you've lost it. You've lost it. So I think it is all about, you know, going with the audience, with the stakeholders, and transforming them. Only then true transformation can happen. So it's a very hard, very, very hard game. Yeah. And probably the challenges are changing, are evolving, but you have the equal amount of challenges in a domain like this.
So when you started off, like you said, you had a lot of sympathetic support from your family. So what made you carry on? What were, you know, in hard reality, what were metrics that you looked at to say, yes, I am doing well? It could not just be revenue, it could just be anything else. But what did you see saying, like, this is, I'm doing well, I'm not going to stop, I'm going to keep pushing it.
Revenue is important because you don't want to go back to your family and say, I need more money, right? I never did that, thankfully. I didn't have to. That's very important. I can't disregard. But more importantly, I think my belief in myself and the team was built very, very nicely, as you put it, on certain metrics, not so much written out and stuff like that, but in terms of anecdotes, in terms of schools coming back saying that this is so beautiful, parents calling us and saying, you know what, my outlook to my child has changed. So then you know that you are doing something right. And within the organization, people wanting to be with EZVidya, even in not so great times in the early years, you know, you would sometimes wonder. I've asked my salesman, in fact, he quoted this in a recent discussion with him. He said, sometime back you asked me, in a very bad year when we hardly did any sales, apparently I asked him, for a salesman, sales is what keeps him going, right? I mean, for 3 years you don't sell. I asked him, why are you still in EZVidya? And I think that has motivated us, because there is so much of belief by top talent to stay with you, to stay in this movement. So then you feel even more responsible. I would say my scale bug has come only because of the people we know. Personally, until 5 years ago, I was like, fine. I mean, I think I'm doing quality work. I'm doing, you know, what I want to do. I'm very happy, sleeping well in the night. But the scale up comes because people are like, you know, my friends want to join EZVidya when they see me. And, you know, this kind of things makes you feel like you have every right to grow big. And the other thing, Sriram, is also about competition or the ecosystem not having better companies. That also is a big metrics for me. So I still know that you are far ahead. And I still know that the time has not come when there are many such good companies. Even today, if you take startups, there are many educational startups. Most of them are driven by tech-centric approach. I'm not saying it's wrong, it's very important. In fact, I'd like to today also tell you guys that if you have tech-centric people who are interested in education, please come to EZVidya, we can work together. But just that will not work. You need a very highly pedagogic, very highly sound philosophical aspects of education taken care of. You need a company like that. Otherwise, there is a danger that the entire ecosystem can move towards tech-led learning with no solid substance, no solid direction for kids, which is very dangerous. So even today, it's very sad, after so many years, the closest that somebody says is a good, authentic, error-free material is the NCERT books. Then what are the intellectuals in this country doing? Why aren't we able to bring more such materials? We should be flooded, right? Indian. That's because nobody takes on this as a serious thing. So that is why these are metrics that makes me feel I have to be here. And about 6 years back, because we were doing training very well, we were doing material development, content development very well, they were very alluring, tempting offers from corporates to say that, would you like on e-learning with us? would you like to take corporate training, etc. And we said no. Because to me, there are many takers for that. Any HR professional, any content company can take. But people do not want to invest their time on this. And that is where I see a big business opportunity. I'm not even saying opportunity to do something noble or whatever. I'm hardcore entrepreneur as of today. Okay, maybe led by some very sound sensitivity and responsibility to the society. But I can't, I'm not in a food space. I need the money of any organization. So these are the metrics that make me stay. And I think sometimes I thank all the sarcasm around me and say, this is what pushed me to stay back as well. you know, meaning it was well-intentioned sympathy. But people don't realize that it could have a very strong negative or a hands-off impact. I could have just retired, you know, long back.
Now, when you started off doing your products and the services that you offer, you would have obviously gone through a lot of challenges in terms of economic acceptance, but even faults in the product itself, faults in, you admit there could be something wrong, it could be one page or something. So, did you test market it anywhere, and also what are the kind of challenges that you face as an organization as you?
There is a process of beta testing, proof of concept, etc. But I don't think that should, in education, in the dynamism that is involved, every year, every 5 years, I'm seeing the children coming out are so different that you can afford to do a long testing and then, you know, so there is a risk there, but our philosophy has been, what is the, how high the stake is in a mistake. It can be a simple content error, it can be something that will work as well. So that's one attribute. So yes, we do beta testing, we do proof of concept, but I don't think we give undue timeline for that. When we are ready with something, I think we know the schools, we know the teacher psyche very well. Today, after a decade, we just go whole hog, and it's so dynamic that an error is not forever. So there is also certain benchmarking that we have, very continuous feedback that we receive, and then validate it, etc. That's the answer to your first question. What is the second question?
What are the challenges you face as you grow? Because there are pain points for any company starting up and growing. So, what kind of challenges?
So, in terms of business, profitability and margins has been a huge challenge even when we got a lot of sales, because the same dynamism that I'm talking about means that we have release of the same material with newer add-ons and value adds, which means every year there's a lot of investment. I've had my board asking me, where is all this money going into the R&D? You know, you are every year knocking off. Which means there is a lot, and sales also is a very long cycle, because our sales is educated sales. Actually, the salesman going and educating the principal or the decision maker. So all this initially had, though we grew in terms of the number of schools, etc., there was always this question mark from pure investors. I mean, that's again a very close family and friends kind of a thing. They would ask, you seem to be working so hard, are the results coming in terms of profitability? Today, I think we have crossed over and we are seeing profitability, but still the EBITDA percentage may not be as desirable, but we are working towards it. So that's been a major challenge because of the nature of the work and our own philosophy. The same, if we have taken a decision that you don't need to put in so much money in R&D and just continue, then I feel the success also would have diminished, right? So there is always a... So that, I think, is one of the biggest challenges. Second biggest challenge, I think I touched upon it, is getting the right people. Which is... And it's not just the money. It's not like, even if I'm ready to give some money, you get the right kind of people. People who are self-motivated. People who are very strongly rooted in the cause of what we are doing. Alongside good community. Good whatever is not so easy to get, and perhaps since we are working with schools, I jokingly and also more seriously tell people that maybe 10 years down the line we won't have this problem, because children who have gone through our curriculum would be very readily able to take things. So I'm just waiting for that day when I just have to ask them, have you gone through chrysalis in school? Then you can come and join EZVidya. So, but that has to wait, because you know the quality of output from colleges and whatever today is. And it's not that, I think it's the single most big challenge for us in terms of skill. We are not getting the right kind of talent, and patient talent. You know, they have to really learn for some time. It's not like from year one I'm going. So we are working very hard in showing them growth path. These are also responsibilities of an entrepreneur, right? I have to really show them where you could be, your personal interests, how does it match with these over there. So I think our concern for employee growth is also a kind of a slow. It's getting us on a slow track. But I think that's the biggest challenge. Third challenge, I would say, is also the educational policies of the government, which suddenly throws us out of gear. Suddenly, 1 year they say you should use only Samachi books, and then our salesmen don't know what to do, schools don't know what to do. There's no clarity. See, if there's a clarity, if you go to Singapore, you know that all books have to be approved by the Ministry of Education. At least there is a transparency, you can go and get the approval from them. In our governments, we find that lack of clarity as the biggest bane. So school decision makers will tell us, we don't know, we love your product, but we don't know whether we can take it. We have to wait for someone to tell us. So this is also making us plan in a big way to the B2C market. Currently we are only B2B. But we know that there are certain things that will affect the B2B, and we are now preparing ourselves because we do not want that to thwart reaching to many other children, so we are also effectively coming out. So these are all responsive steps that we need to take. I think that those are the biggest three challenges.
In terms of, because of working in the education space, everyone's not always going to be on time. There will be some credit period, there will be so how do you manage all that?
Payments?
Payments.
I can say that there are geographical trends. And we now know Andhra Pradesh when to expect or not expect payment at all. Again, just between the four walls. And then you know, you have a 10%, 15% what we call as green schools that you don't even have to call them for payments. Luckily, a percentage of our revenues also come from corporates. We are into working with big corporates on their corporate social responsibility. Work in the government, so we have some cash flow there. We are also adequately preparing ourselves for other ways in which cash flows can be. And I think if a metrics for a sign of growth for an enterprise can be also outstandings and bad debts. You sometimes feel a vicarious pleasure in saying I have bad debts of so much percent, which means you have grown. I think that's an Indian economic situation. But we believe that financial discipline is very important, so we have role modeled that. And today we have a unique intervention. I won't say much about it because it's not yet released, but where we want to bring in financial discipline in schools as well. Educate schools on financial discipline, because I simply think it is indiscipline. It's nothing to do with, see, schools get fees and they just have to take a portion of that and give us, because no parent, except in some Andhra Pradesh, that's a serious problem, that parent fee outstanding is to the range of 40-50%. Can you imagine you not paying your child's fee and getting away with it? They do that in AP, right, Ganesh? 40-50%. And so there is, but there are in Tamil Nadu and other places, you have fantastic parents coming and paying, and still the school says, I can't pay you. So, but we are now trying to work around it. But I would think the third focus of any entrepreneur should be to very proactively start addressing cash flow as an imminent threat to your growth. you know, it is bound to be there, except maybe in some consultancy and stuff like that, where it is a single man army. Because you, and I can proudly declare today, in a decade of EZVidya, we have not made a salary default of a payment or even a delay in the last 10 years. You can check that out. That's something that I hold very dear. And there was one month in who tell us that with EZVidya there's no problem. I feel temporary pain in ensuring this discipline has a long-term positive effect. So that's another key thing for an entrepreneur, that you need to be very disciplined. But I would also say that such discipline sometimes slows your growth. But it's sustainability versus growth, quick growth. For me, sustainability and slow and steady progress is more important. Today, there are many companies that started with us and become irrelevant today. Or companies that have reached a peak and today they are nowhere. But I think that entrepreneur has also decided to make quick buck and go away or start another company. That's a different mindset. So I am nobody here to say that entrepreneurs should have only this mindset. But if you are looking for a long-term, sustainable, organic build of your company, then have these characteristics. But if you want to be a serial entrepreneur, if you want to make a quick buck, sell it off, and then start another company, then there are other things to do. Financial discipline may not be the right attribute there. I mean, you may not see the quick buck.
So, but could you start off by yourself? The question that most entrepreneurs have, the issue that most people have, they start off is you bootstrap, so your own savings or some money from family doing it. How do you use that to actually go into, even if you don't get external investors, so how do you actually use your own money? Obviously, sensibly, but what do you do to make sure that you scale up?
I don't like to use the word luck, but to this answer, I may have to use that things have gone well for us. It is only a decision of I can't have more investments going into better R&D or expansion. It has never been money for business as usual, because we have ensured that there is a continuous revenue stream coming. It's only when you have a long haul before you get into revenues, that is when you have these problems. For us, it was revenue from day one. It would have been weaker revenue, it would have been not so great revenue. There's some money coming in. And otherwise, I think it's time. I mean, if we are very consciously saying that I'm not going to get the returns I won't even say returns. I don't think whether we got the returns, I don't know. But in terms of revenues not coming in, and it's a conscious call, then one has to be prepared for a perennial flow from somewhere. That somewhere can be investments, external investments, your own money. But again, that needs financial discipline. For you to go back to your drawing board and say, for 3 years, this is the money I need, and where are the avenues in which I'm going to get that money? Otherwise, if you have a promising revenue stream that can take care of your business as usual, then it kind of caters. So I think for us, in terms of business as usual, there has never been an issue. But we have felt those stress very consciously, because the growth path comes only if you hit the feel that you're not getting enough money. Otherwise, it's getting the money, spending it, 80% of it. That's not the way a business person looks at things.
Now, the other thing that we've been hearing, at least a startup brand for this, is a co-founder is extremely crucial. And starting up on your own will be very difficult, because there's so many things to do, one person can't. In your case, I think you started off with one, but you were lucky if I knew that one to get a good team very early on. So what would be your thoughts on that?
Thoughts on how to get them?
No, not how to get them. But in a sense, was that one of the crucial things for your
own? Absolutely. I think if it had not been the support of the people in my organization, and I can say that there was no sympathy in that part of the support. I had ruthless people, colleagues who would say that, things on my face. I think one needs to listen to people. Though I would still say I can be perceived as very autocratic when it comes to holding the vision or, uncompromising on some things, because there are some colleagues in desperation who come and say, why can't we just do this to the school, you know? And I'm very uncompromising on those very core values. But I think it's the team that one has to take as oneself. A founder is just founded. And that's the only thing that my designation says. It's not about, today where we are is not just me. In fact, it's about other people. So I think taking along a team, making them feel important, and making them feel listened to, and authentically listening to are very key. For, I think it's all about the core team that has worked. And slowly expanding that circle. And Rocky Srinam, I should also talk about some schools that has been with us. And I would particularly say one of our biggest clients, Wipro, who were our first corporate clients in their CSR. I think these people without whom we couldn't be where we are, because they were patient. Schools have been patient with us, saying, I think I know your intent. So if it's not working, we know why it's not working. We are with you. You know, that's very important. So I think that relationship with our initial clients, being transparent with them, being honest with them. Sometimes I had to go and tell them, I want to do this for you, but I don't have the wherewithal. I don't have the people right now to do this for you. They will be open. So many times I think entrepreneurs, you know, want to create this artificial thing of everything is fine. To everybody. I think that's also not so good. You have to be honest. And people like Wipro has stimulated us, has questioned us, at the same time being patient to say, let's see if your experiment works. Let's see if your... So that patience, I think, is also important. So your team plus some critical stakeholders, like clients, are also a big part of your success.
So, last two questions before I hand over. What would be your advice for budding entrepreneurs? Any advice?
Yeah, I think whatever I said already had a lot embedded. I don't know if advice is a great word, but I would say that resilience is the key. So that there will be moments when people feel very frustrated, being not understood. I think you have to choose your friends very carefully. I have been immensely supported by friends and some colleagues who have made me feel like you are right. You know, you have to hold on. So it's very important. If you surround yourself by people who will be like, hey, idhu pella nee anga TCS lerna you would have made by now, look at your opportunity cost. It can be very logical argument. It can be very logical argument that somebody tells you, no, have you calculated your opportunity cost? 3 years you have done this and there is no sight of any success, then I would say don't go by that, because I've heard that many times too, and that is one big thing. So resilience and surrounding yourself by positive people who can, and that doesn't mean like simply saying you're great, you know, you should, I mean that discernment should be there. It's not sycophancy or somebody misleading you to say one day success will come. Also, I think personally I believe that to use your right words, have metrics, not just seeing the goal. There are indicators and they should be shorter span. They should be more visible. So if your goal is to get there, that may be elusive at times. But if your metrics are there, that's happened with me. I mean, if my goal had been I want to be number one educational company, it's taken me so much or even more. I mean, I'm still not there. But I know that I'm observing the metrics. So if the metrics are right, and you can definitely get there. And make the metrics aspirational. Sometimes we make the metrics so easy that we seem we attain it. So it should be a little aspirational. It should push your benchmark. So I think that's another thing. And I go back to my first statement, get into entrepreneurship only if you care about what you're doing. Sometimes you start with that care, sometimes you bump into that care inadvertently. You might have started something because a friend offered you something and then you said, okay, let me grab. But after a period of time, if you're not feeling so very strongly about the domain or about the product or about whatever, even if the money is coming, I'm telling you, that's not entrepreneurship. You have to be very passionate about your everyday thing. It can be the product, it can be the service, it can be what it does to the ecosystem. Otherwise, if it's simply the bank balance, I think you'd be better off than a job. At least you're not putting so many people in peril, right, as a leader. You can't one day quit. See, these things can make you quit all of a sudden. And when you quit, you are actually bringing down a whole ecosystem along with you. So you have to really care about what you're doing as well.
Is there any thought leader or business leader that inspires you?
As of today, I don't know whether it's politically correct to say, I just take people not as a whole. I'm a great admirer of many people, not just in business, but I take attributes and characteristics from everybody. I feel there's a big danger, and it's a personal philosophy, it's not an advice. Personal philosophy is, I'm not a fandom person. In fact, I was tweeting about it yesterday, that it beats me that people can give everything for a person or for a movement or for a political party or anything. Yes, certain ideologies, certain characters, if you take Narendra Modi for example, I admire a few things in him, but it doesn't mean like I will do anything for him. Or you take a Rajnikanth, you take a Bill Gates, you take any big leader, you take even Sheryl Sandberg, whom I'm a big admirer. But it's not this holistic personality. There is no buy-in of this person in totality. I just take a few leaves out of everyone, and I think that's when my individuality comes out. Otherwise, it will be like, can I become like him? Can I become like her? Which may be totally out of context for me. I mean, she's in an American society, and she's a Harvard graduate and had a phenomenal experience. I can never be her. I mean, I'm talking about Sheryl Sandberg, but there are some attributes that I personally think, especially with women entrepreneurship, that I can really relate to what she says and build my thoughts on it. Or even Bill Gates. I was just telling Sriram, I saw the security. I even took a picture of that. I don't know, when you enter IITM research park, it says Microsoft visitors not allowed. I just remembered when I spoke about Bill Gates. But it doesn't mean that, you know, there are attributes in Bill Gates or Steve Jobs that immensely motivates you. But they are poles apart, right? I mean, if you look at a Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, to anybody they are two different, totally contrasting people. So you have to see what you would like to take from each one. So I don't think I can name one role model or one thought leader, but obviously, there's a lot of talk about Steve Jobs within EZVidya because of innovation, because of quality consciousness, or because of ruthlessness I would say even teases customers, right? He doesn't cater to them, he teases and then gets them into his fold. So these are things perhaps we are doing in some way. So he would be the closest contender, I guess, but it's not one person.
So that's it for my
own question.
So,
I have two questions actually. So you started off with B2C and then moved into B2C, B2B, right? So why did that transition happen? Why not continue with B2C?
My B2C model was a brick and mortar, children coming to my garage turned whatever. So I don't know if it's really B2C in my today's definition. What gives me a huge aspiration to go back to B2C, like I said, the reach. And I know the reach comes from technology. So today the world has changed from 10 years, right? Today I can actually think of reaching to every kid in the country if they have a tablet or a laptop. So that gives the courage. So I don't know that I'm going back to that B2C model. Yeah.
The second question would be that you had mentioned everyone says it's okay if it's not successful, it's okay if you take a rest or something. But isn't that something good for everyone? Everyone pushes someone for something and let everyone do it for passion and not for the output. Isn't that a good thing?
But what if I had heeded the advice and retired that day to my couch, very comfortable,
No, it's not about giving up. It's like, if you're not successful enough, you still go ahead and do what for your passion.
That's exactly
like
what I did. What I was talking about is people saying, you have two kids, you can focus a lot on them, you can focus a lot on maybe a family business that was there.
Okay.
So, for me, that advice would have meant retracting to something else. And I didn't want to do that.
No, because
I mean,
for me right now when I'm starting it, there are two sets of people. One who is saying, like, why can't you continue a job where you earn, just like Amit said. And another said, like, fine, go ahead, do something and make something out of it. And someone who is jealous of me quitting my job and doing, and even if it's not going to be successful. There are different.
So that's why the discernment is entirely yours. You have to discern. There can be some people saying that, you quit, then do like you say. But then it's not that you're going to just listen to them, right? I'm only saying, these are all signals and statements that will surround you in a journey of entrepreneurship. There are 1,000 views, like parenting. If you go ask someone, am I okay doing this to my kid, you will have hundreds of opinions there. Somebody will say, no, thrashing is what is important. Somebody will say, no, never thrash. This is how you must. So ultimately, I don't think there is a theory for parenting. So there is no theory for entrepreneurship, but listening and following your heart and strengthening your gut with some logical aspect is what is it. It's only you who can decide. So my advice there is, listen, it's important to understand points of view. I mean, even what I'm saying today may not be suitable for each one of you, but then there are some stimulation and thoughts that come. Ultimately, listen to what you feel. Yeah.
Have a few questions. It's not just one. One thing which I found in India, especially in the Indian scenario, is to have a good business, to scale it up, and to move ahead with your vision and all that, you need contacts, solid business contacts, or at least you may have astounding potential. It's like a job search. I mean, I have personally experienced that. So, I'm sorry if I just digress a little. But I had a certain skill set. It was very unique, top notch. But I didn't have the opportunity in India. And you will actually find, topics like biotechnology and others, which they will say when you put on some news, wow, seriana potential, everybody should go. On ground, you tell me anybody is employed in biotech in Chennai. Doesn't work out. The same thing happens with any kind of business. Therein, you may be offering the best product, you may be offering the best thing, but you should actually have people to listen to. At least encourage you, give you the time, and for that, Mama, Macham, Bangal, this kind of relation actually works. Still in India, it's not like the US where everybody is independent, where it's technology driven 100%. So given that kind of niche and going 10 years back when you started, when there was not even too much of a cell phone penetration, how did you exactly manage to get those contacts? Yeah, garage wise, fine, that makes a good start. But then to scale up to a corporate level, because I personally, you have stellar qualifications. You go give it to a HR in Wipro, in say, imagine this is for an employee, for a job. What about a business? So how did you reach that level? What kind of path did you take to get those contacts?
I completely agree that one needs contacts. There's no two ways about it. But I don't believe that that's for a head start. Okay, it's like, let me take this animation movie that's released yesterday as an example. If it had not been the daughter of Rajinikanth who had taken, it would have seen a lot more less acceptance or more criticism. It's a head start that I have this clout, I have this contact. Obviously, for a Ranbir Kapoor to come, I'm just taking film as an example, to come and become a success, or somebody else who's absolutely not from a filmy background or doesn't have the godfathers, as we say. I think it's very similar in the industry and entrepreneurship as well. This, I think, is very important for head start. So, I would say even I didn't have godfathers, or I had experiences where people said they can be my godfathers and I turned them down. There have been people who come to us and say, for your potential, for your brains, for your team, we can go here, we can become a 100 crore company, we can become a 200 crore company. I think we should be very, very, you know, equanimous in such situations. That doesn't mean that you will not succeed if you do not have the head start. It may be slower, but it is important. You people have a startup network today. You have mentoring today. You have a CII today. I don't think 10 years back, I didn't even know of these things. Because like you said, no, cell phone, technology, social media, nothing. Today, social media has brought so many early startups to popularity very quickly. And app world today is something that I can just, you know, through just Facebook and whatever. Today, I have a nephew who's made a presentation in Austin, 20-year-old guy. And he talks about when I told him I like to invest, he's developed an app. And I said, I want to invest. He said, no, no, you can't afford it. I'm looking at raising $2 million. That's the language a 20-year-old talks. And at 30, I was like, where do I start? But understanding the criticality of building relationships, effective communication, whatever medium you choose. Today it's easier, I can just get that on technology, it would be more difficult. But we have to be smart enough to get that going. The contact building climate is much, much better today. So I just want to tell you that I see a lot of pessimism in people who feel that I'm not backed by influence. I'm not, you know, having that clout. Let that not make you pessimistic, is my only plea. Find other ways. And I also go by the school of thought, it is not just brains in a particular domain that can get you anywhere. It is interpersonal relationship. It is going out of that. Whatever brain I have, I can do a PhD somewhere with my brain, but if I want to become an entrepreneur, I have to face it. I have to build my contacts. It could, for somebody influential, it can happen overnight. For somebody, it will take a long, long time. But we have to be patient about it.
Sure. And
I just want to respond to this.
Okay.
Having come here with Chitra, I have to just give myself a copy of it. if you're coming from this plane of can I be successful in entrepreneurship without contacts? Yes. If it's a dilemma between should I start a enterprise with contacts?
Oh, it's starting, you mean?
Starting.
I have to build it.
Yeah.
No, it's more related. The point is, it's not only about the startup.
Yeah, so
because the flow, the river has to flow. Right?
Yeah, so for me, if you have to look at the way you look at contact itself, is really the best contacts are your first clients.
Yes,
in a way. Even before that, your best contact should be somebody who has listened to you for 30 minutes and say, yeah, that's a wonderful thing. Go ahead. He's a wonderful. So for me personally, I believe that you don't have to really build your contacts as assets before you start. It'll come along the way. And as I'll
but
go back to
Ganesh is the best person because he heads our business development in EZVidya, so no better guy can say that. But I want to just tell you, think of building contacts as an asset or as an attribute required for entrepreneur. You can have the best product, best whatever, if you do not build contacts. The favorable climate for people like you now is the avenues. So you should somehow get into these avenues and build contacts. And I think that is very critical. Otherwise, bird is not going to come falling at your feet. There are too many people out there, and visibility is important. You cannot say, I have the best product, I'll sit here and it will come to me. You will have to go there. After 10 years, we are still going there. It's not like we can sit and get it. You know, you have to go there. And for some domains, more so. I don't know, you are in biotech domain?
I think we'll have a talk about
sure,
it later.
Sure.
But this particular concept that you told is a certain anarchy that I'm trying to break. So all the guys here, I'll just come back to you once I have solid results and credentials on the same.
Okay.
But this idea of this contacts and, you know, this personal face to an enterprise is something that I'm trying to, you know, to rise above the picture, so to say. And that relates a lot to also the way I perceive things.
Probably I'll just come back to you maybe 1 or 2 months.
Sure. No, again, I think I want to clarify here. I don't know if we are having the same definition of building contacts, and I think it will be outside the purview of this forum. But it shouldn't be that we are talking about building contacts in different with different definitions in mind. Because building contacts to me is not building influence of people, influential people. That's not what I'm talking about. Or on one extreme, the Godfathers, you can put in a word. It is simply building relationship, according to me. And the relationship can either refer you to the right customers, or the relationship could end with the customer, vendor, service provider relationship. So that's my definition. It's not, even I don't believe that we have to rub shoulder. In fact, I'll be the only CEO who's not had a business dinner in like a decade. I never go out for business dinners unless I have a client coming. I never go to just, you know, these are all can be perceived as weakness, but I have my own philosophy and whatever standing on that. So I spend half the time with my 50% of my time is with my colleagues in office. About 30% is the clients, and about 20% is like what I'm doing today, you know, addressing forums, panels. So people say sometimes you reverse it and make 50% of panels, then I say I won't be able to get the product that I'm getting today. So it's all about your priorities and what your strengths are. There can be CEOs who may have all that given away and just do the building relationship, going to panels, traveling to just get investments, etc. But it's about knowing your strengths and weaknesses. I know where my strengths are. I want to build on those strengths. And over a period of time, as the company evolves, I know that I'm spending little more time progressively on things like today. I know when I'm invited to something like this that I can share, and I would like to do that. And I know there will be some relationships starting today. This is also one way of building an ecosystem.
And the last question you can choose not to answer if you want. What do you feel like? Yeah, I get the point that, you know, you've been an entrepreneur, you've struggled, you've got the title, you've been successful. But is there any regret? Is there something that you've lost? Something that you feel you could have done a little better, you know, along your journey? Everybody has
in the enterprise?
Even otherwise, as a human being or as an entrepreneur, you know, these are two different aspects which collide when they come together. Because as you correctly said, there is a support system in the family, the support system in the organization. And all these have to actually come together for you to actually succeed. So it's a lot of strings that are pulled for the puppets to actually work, for the, you know, the show to actually run smooth. So given that kind of scenario, is there any kind of thing that you felt could have been done better?
In my personal life, no. I don't think I have any regrets. I think this journey of entrepreneurship has made me a better human being, a better parent. I have had scenarios when this has been reassured by my own kids. Like when my daughter was in class 7, and I felt that every child comes home to have be fed by the mom, and I wouldn't be there, I would be traveling. I've asked her once, so do you feel that I don't give you food? And she told me, give us food for thought. I thought it was a brilliant statement that reassured that I'm on the right track. So personally, I don't have any regrets. I have missed on some things, but that is something that I would like to miss on. Like maybe, you know, taking off. I was on a holiday last week, I was telling Sriram, and in the cruise, thinking a lot about, you know, my mails and all that, but I like it that way. It's a choice I'm making. There are no personal regrets at all, I would say very, very honestly. Within the organization, I wish I had the buck to scale at least 3-4 years ahead of when we had that. I feel a lot of time I've spent on telling myself we are ready to scale, we have to get the foundation. I think an entrepreneur cannot be as cautious as I was in the initial years. And that has made me come out very strongly. Today I'm like, I have to get there, you know. That's come out very strongly because it's a huge learning for me that at least 4 years, I have, I won't say wasted, but again, just for, I can't think of a better word. I have dilly-dallied too long on whether it's whether quantity will affect quality. I thought I was doing debates, like, you know, our TV debates for too long. I think that was the only thing. I would say regret. Regret is a very strong word. But looking back in retrospect, if I were to rewind, I would have rewound at least 4 years before. That's the only thing. But personally, I think I'm very happy where I am and what I have.
Thank you. You have a business plan when you started off?
No, not at all. Business plan, if you're looking at it, is what I would have now when I go to an investor, not at all. Because the investment was very meager. It didn't call for someone to ask me, or even me to ask me where I or returns, etc. But I had a plan in mind. I had a plan on where I was putting in the money and what is the revenue stream. So to that extent, a simple spreadsheet was there. But it wasn't even targets of this is what it would be. It's only in the third year or fourth year when we saw steady revenues trickling in, we went back to the drawing board and said, I think we need to really understand where our energy should be, where our, and it's only about 7 years now that we are even talking budgets and all that as organizations. So it's a very organically blossomed company. Yeah, sure.
When you are telling the founder, then you have to create a team. What language you are talking to the team? Because salary is one thing, but the thing to motivate them to follow your idea, believe in your idea, and they, because that, those persons are going to be in the front seat of the idea of yours. There are clients, whether it is going to be B2B or B2C or whoever they are. But the same time, you are not going to be on the selling point. The selling masters has to be there.
I think more than what kind of language, I would say one thing should be consistency in the code. If we start sending different signals, the trust that the team has on you will lose it. I think clarity and consistency are two things. But consistency doesn't mean that we are not dynamic. You know, there are some core that will never change. Right, especially in a domain like ours, there are some core aspects that we believe in that will never change. And if I think we have to be very careful that what we are saying from point to point has to be so clear and consistent that they should not see you dilly-dallying, or they should not see, even she's in doubt, I think she's now coming around. These are things that can send very bad signals. And that comes only with self-belief, right? You have to believe, and your conviction should be very, very strong. Assertiveness, which is not aggressiveness. I'm not at all an aggressive person, but I think when you sit together and say that, I think I understand your point of view, but let's go back to what we strongly believe in. These are some of the things for which I think you need absolute clarity on what you believe in. If we are not sure, see, methods, strategies, these can evolve and change, but the core beliefs and the product attributes cannot change. And if we have a strong sense of it, it can make anything acceptable. And it's not one-sided, it is also listening to others' point of view.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I think one other thing about, and it's also an answer to what he asked, entrepreneurship is all about communication. And even silence has to communicate something, according to me. Right? It's about communication, it's about inspiration, it is about propagating the vision. It's not just about functionally taking decisions for operations, it's a lot about communication. And thankfully, I think I have been, I look at entrepreneurship, to just give you an idea, as expression. I say that. Why did you get into this? Because I wanted to express myself, and no better forum to have your own company, your own whatever, to express yourself. So I think that's what has also made me not regret. I'm able to communicate, I'm able to express myself. So an organization is a space for expression, it's an outlet for your individual.
And when you're making choices, That's the very critical thing, like what we choose, that's going to be the destination. Right? So when you are taking choices, what are the things that you will be taking this choice? Is there anything that you can like?
Yeah, I follow my heart. I'm a very intuitive person.
But at times you will have that.
Of course you will. I mean, you will have. What I'm trying to say, it's all not about analysis and putting a spreadsheet all the time, right? It is about some risks which can be cut. And the choice, whether it's a good or a bad choice, is never known to you until, I don't know, it's never known to you which is better. But I think the other thing is, once the choice and decision is making, not going back and forth on it or even cribbing about it or going back and saying, I mean, that's why I said, it's, yeah, today looking back, I could have done this, that's all. I'm not going to overtly worry about it or hurt myself about it, which will pull you down. But I don't think there is one Konar notes for making the choices. It's about each individuality. You don't have a guideline on this is how you make a decision. But having said that, we are bringing decision making as a big skill among even primary kids. Because I feel children are not taught to make decisions. And so that is something that we are bringing into schools and school kids. So that decisions are not made hurriedly and, you know. It's a continuous.
Even yesterday she was fighting with me. She says that the entire system of examination should be eliminated. I was telling her, how can we gauge you? Like, you're going to be an architect after 3 years. But the same thing, whether you're going to give a sketch, which is going to be right or wrong, how can we know?
Yeah, that's because examinations are not taken as diagnostic assessment. It's taken as a high-stake judgment. That's what we are trying to redefine also. We are saying any assessment is about diagnostic assessment. You take a medical test, it throws, right, whether you're unwell or well. That's not the way we look at, right? We don't go back to the person and say, you have fared poorly in these areas. I mean, most of the report cards today have can do better. How does it help anybody, right? So we ask teachers. So you make a nice breakfast in the morning and your husband says, how is it, can do better, and goes away, will you like it? No, not at all. He should tell us whether the salt was less or whatever. Then he say, why do you do that to your kids? Most of them write on the report card, can do better, which is not at all assessment evaluation of somebody. So coming back to your question, it's a dynamic feedback we get, continuous feedback from students. We have our people visiting schools, sitting, dialoguing. So, it is something that we see, perceive. If we ask children, everybody will say, please take our feedback, eliminate exams. That's not the answer. So we have to find ways. That's a very important part of EZVidya as well. Yeah. You had a question.
First of all, thanks a lot for the time. I just a question, either for you or for your help, is that when you started out, I mean, you had some schools, some people already knew what you were doing. They told you, oh, you should meet this person, that person, this school. Now, how do you approach this? How do you go out and how do you get those channels to find more and more schools which take on your software? And then you said you were thinking of expanding internationally. So, yeah, you're doing marketing, you know, sales, and how do you approach that perspective when it's not just someone saying, oh, call this person, call that person? How do you market yourself?
Are you in an educational startup?
I was working for one in Canada.
Okay. Ganesh, you want to quickly answer?
You.
No. See, I think we have a very strong. One other thing that we started right from, you can sit, started right from the beginning, like I said, culture and stuff like that. We were very early on to develop a fantastic information system, an analytics tool. Even when we were very small. And today that's helping us to even understand trends in decision making in schools. Who really is the decision maker is something you'll never know. You'll be talking to a principal and finally you'll know that principal has no authority, no guts to even go and tell the owner of the school that this should be there. So we have identified certain things based on our information system, and every year our sales strategy is based on the learnings that we get. So today we know exactly how many footfalls it takes to get there. Beyond this number of optimal footfalls, you are not going to get, because see, ideally you would say more number of visits, the chances of getting a deal is more, but it's actually wrong. If a person is going and we see in the MIS, we see in the information system that he's gone there 10 times, and there are, again, we have metrics. What has been the progress of your
sale? So is this like a trial of the software, or?
It could be simply presenting. It could be a demo. It could be whatever. There are metrics that we know is progressing. And so if the progress is not there and they are what we call as dead visits, exceed, then we tell the guy mercilessly, stop going to that school. Because it's efficiency that matters most. And even things like, you know, what retains, we just to give you one quick idea of one of the learnings we had. We have in every school three key stakeholders who help us decide: the decision maker, the principal, and the teacher. All three have to, what we realized over a period of time is, sometimes only decision maker is met and he gets so interested, he says, yeah, I'm going to take it this year. We realize these schools are not retainable after a year, because there was no buy-in from the teacher, there is no buy-in from the principal. End of the year, they give a very bad feedback only because I have not been consulted in this. It's simply an attitudinal hitch that I have. So what we are now doing is, we have what is called a TPD compliance. We check if, even if the decision maker says, hey, I think I love your product, our salesman seeks a time for a demo with the teacher. Sometimes it can be seen as very regressive. New salesmen who come ask Ganesh, what boss, you have, actually this guy is saying come and take the order, you want me to now go and ask time for a teacher presentation. But it is what our analytics say. It may be one day more, but it is a 3-year retention. So these are all, I don't want to give away more of our secrets. I know Ganesh is already staring at me. But there are several such secrets as assets for us, you know. So that's why I easily gave one secret away. So you have to be all the time also analyzing certain things, and what may seemingly seem wrong is, these are all contributing to sustainability. Today we have a 94% retention, which I think without a tangible asset is never ever in the history of educational companies. Maybe an educom can do that because they have leased a plasma TV or whatever, but interactive whiteboard, which is a tangible thing. We don't have any such thing. We enjoy a 94% retention of clients, which is, I think, phenomenal. So all this comes only because of various parameters.
First of all, I would appreciate your initiative towards the social responsibility, right? Meaning, like, you are trying to change the way the children see education and parents see education, which is really good. But unless the basic education system changes, all that we are talking to the school and they are accepting it, maybe they might be using that as a tool or a value add to showcase that, you know, they are good above the other schools here, right? But ultimately, if you look at it, yesterday the 10th results have come up, and people are thinking, you know, for 500 out of 500 and 499, 19 people, 300 people, whatever it is, right? But that's not success. Not that, you know, a person who has taken 480 or 470 is not intelligent or is not going to really achieve anything in life, right? As long as the basic education system changes, all these things will be a value add, and it is not going to change the way that we see the education. Are you talking to the government or, you know, any other initiative that you are taking to change this educational system? How children see, right? One of the examples that she said, examination, right? Always they say that I need to go, mark them, go and write something, right? Unless that changes, and if we, I don't think so, these are all the things that will really help, right?
I think I like the whole thing except the last statement.
Okay.
I mean, when you give up saying unless all that changes, this will not work, that defeats your mission. I completely agree. What you're doing is a drop in the ocean unless the whole system changes. But how does the whole system change? It can either be a bottom-up approach or it can be a top-down. And I would say EZVidya is working on both. At the top-down, we are working with governments. We are already trying to see now the new government, how can we pass our recommendations, how can we meet them, MHRD or CBSE board. We are empaneled by CBSE after 8 long years, you know, we have got into CBSE empanelment as a agency that provides training for leaders, school leaders, etc. That's the top down. Bottom up, we have to make a difference, even if seemingly a very small percentage in the ground. Because both are important for us to find the change happening. We can't wait for the system to change and then start. Or we cannot just start here and say, I won't go there. So, I think it's true of every entrepreneur, because every entrepreneur is a part of an ecosystem which will have big policies, whatever that governs, disempowered decision makers, buyers, etc. So your influence has to be in all areas. So I would say things are changing. CBSE has come up with assessment reforms in a big way, but still, you know, lot of implementation problems are there, but things are looking good, and I'm sure with the global integration and things happening, flow of information. Today we have so many parents who've come from different countries demanding changes with their schools. So they come back and say, you know what, we are talking about project-based learning, we are talking about whatever, and the principal says, can you help with all that? That's a very welcome thing. But you also have parents who are pulling it down. There are some school principals who are going by what they want to. For example, we recommend that in kindergarten, children are not made to write so much. And then the principal buys in, and the parents come and say, my neighbor's kid writes when he's 2.5. You are still not doing writing. So it's a very tough fight, because very heterogeneous group out there. So that's again a big challenge for what Sriram was asking. So all this needs complete conviction in what you do and continuous communication. You can't, if you are dancing to the tunes of various people, neither one nor there. So you have to be solidly grounded in what you want.
Sriram Bhomish, I'll add a very strong statement. Very strong statement is, if somebody wants to wait till the system change, be an employee.
My point was not that, right? You know, we are addressing the schools at the same time, it has to be the other level.
Absolutely.
My point is that, you know, we have to address these two things together. That's what she answered, right? They are doing that also.
Absolutely.
Question was, you know, whether are you doing that or just you are focusing on...
No, I think that you are very right. It won't work until that is also coming towards
right.
And transformation happens in the middle ground, right? And the middle ground is the ideal ground, according to me. It's not a compromise. It's an ideal ground. So you start here and you reach there and they come there. So I think it's a very valid question, and we have recognized that at least in the past 4 years, we are doing a lot to influence, certain things in our own way, make recommendations. We were a big part of what is now today claimed as the biggest thing that happened to Indian education, called the National Curriculum Framework in 2005. We were a part of the whole thing. So we were able to put down a lot of our thoughts there. So that should happen at the thought leadership level. We are trying to see how to influence this. We are going to come out with more thought leadership initiatives, where it may not be just talking about our products or our company. It's about thought leadership on education itself, and have forums. So these are all in the cards.
Thank you.
My name is Balakam Arika. So the question to you is, in business, when it comes to customer service, client servicing, it's not that we always make good customers. Sometimes there are customers whose expectations are more than what we could serve.
Is that a bad
customer? The quality of service that you are talking about, and you say that the school supports you, though your product is good, that is working here. mean, it's not always easy situation. Some people expect more. There's value addition. There's value addition what they expect of. They would not want to terminate the agreement. They want to stay with us, but the expectation will always be more than what we could serve. How do you handle such people? Have you come across some people like this?
Definitely.
And sometimes in business, we'll have to say no to customer.
Right,
we cannot be hostile at all. But they won't understand because of their situation, their expectation. How do you handle such things?
So I would categorize expectations in three pockets now that you ask me. One is expecting higher quality in what is in the framework of our service and product. One is expecting more, which is a little outside our framework of agreement. Third is expecting something different. Okay, so simple policy is if it's expecting something different, and the different is actually contradicting or conflicting to what you are giving, say a very assertive no and say this is not possible. For example, I can say one simple thing. I was talking to you about writing in kindergarten. There are schools that say, please, yeah, just give one book which says children can write, my parents will be happy. This is expecting something totally ideologically different to what you are offering, right? Even in the product, it's not just service. There, it's an assertive no. I'm sorry, this is not what we have, you know, come to you for. It is against or it's conflict. Then there is this class of people who will expect more and more. I think we have to pause and reflect if this is a good ground to test, if this can actually become a revenue possibility as well. So there you are going to evaluate this more. For example, we would have committed 5 visits and to sit with 5 training, whatever, and they say, no, you have to give us 8. We are a big client for you, you have to come 10 times. It's not immediate no there. It is to evaluate the purpose. Is it going to really help? If it helps, is it a model we can take on for other, our own servicing model, etc. So there is a bit of an evaluation dialogue before you finally say yes or no. The third thing is expecting higher quality. This is where it's important for us to listen to customers. Maybe what you are giving is not perceived as high quality by them, or they have a genuinely interesting idea that you can borrow. So then you jump at it and you say, I want to learn from these people. And that's how I think we have also evolved our service component. The evolution of service component is from the client listening to the customer needs. You're not going to have a model and say, this is what is the best customer need. You're going to get it from the grounds up. So I would say that don't put it all in one bracket. Put it all in different categories and then decide. And never hesitate. Once it's in this third bracket of ideologically different or something you are not there for, never hesitate to say no. We are, in fact, I have a problem with this customer esteem phrase. If it is misunderstood by your customer service people that the customer is king, so if he wants me to fall on his feet, I should fall on his feet. I don't believe in it at all. I tell them where you are not respected for what you are, where you are asked to do things that you are not meant to be doing, you should learn to say an assertive no. Whoever it is, even the frontliners, we have a lot of deliberations on this, that it has to be mutual respect and mutual understanding. So if that is not there, just walk out. And we have walked out of several deals, to just be honest with you. May not make P&L sense, I think that's what has again contributed to sustainability of our company.
Do you do anything to teach the parents? Because as you say, they demand something which are against. So do you take any steps in teaching them on what should be there?
I would say we communicate to parents, not teach them. Yeah, we do communicate. It's very important. I think you brought a very important part. Because parent is a very important stakeholder, is ultimately the guy who pays. Though it's a school that gives us the check, the parent is the one who pays. See, we have this very unique thing of a school owner who gives us the check and decides whether he wants us or not. We have the teacher who influences and says, I need you or not. We have a parent who actually gives the money, and we have the child who's the consumer. So it's not an easy thing, you know, if you're catering to the child, the parent says, I don't want you, you know, I can't buy this. And then if you're catering to them, the school says, I'm not getting money from you, so I don't want to use you. It's a very tricky ecosystem. So parents are very important. We have every year, we have parental workshops and orientation for them. We have, now we're going to come up with newsletters and other aspects that can reach to them. So we cannot ignore them at all. They are very important, even for us to understand their pain points or what they expect from an educational service provider. And now that we are having plans to B2C, it becomes even more important for us to even organize them in our structure.
First of all, thanks for the honest speech. You visible in Tamil, that's what I was saying.
Okay.
See, I have a couple of questions, okay? So when you started, you had a broad idea, something to do for education, I said, okay, you didn't know whether it's your...
See, I think an entrepreneur can, if an entrepreneur has a very creative spirit, if he's a creator, I'll again classify entrepreneurs in different brackets and...
Just to give you a background, I'm also a chartered accountant.
Okay.
That's why I was just asking you how to conceptualize.
Yeah. So if it's a creative mind that becomes the entrepreneur, then I think creating a product will only give you a satisfaction. It's otherwise you can do good business as a dealer of products, or you know, you can take other products and reach, be the distributor, etc. I think I recognized in our small team and in myself the creator very, very beginning, so we were very clear we are going to conceptualize things. How long it took, I don't think we can put a time frame, because right from year one, we have been rolling out product, but the format has been changing. So we should also look at that. A product is not like, you know, it has to be a full-fledged, ultimate kind of a product. It always has an evolution.
Yeah.
And you can take even an Apple and say that it has evolved. That is that. So I don't know if I can put a time frame. To your question on where our presence is, we are very strongly present in the four southern states and in NCR, Delhi. But this year our plans are to move to the west, north, very, where there's a lot of inquiry and possibility there. And that is our expansion plan. And also, like Sriram was saying, we are also out of the country now. We are in South Africa, we are in Oman, already in Abu Dhabi, UAE. So these are all very promising. We have schools in Singapore as well. So these are all areas that we feel there's a huge potential. And actually for us, Africa is a big market and we're already getting a lot of leads.
Sri Lanka would be very similar education like India.
It does, but it has its own chaos. So, you know, you have to really see how to get there. So that is, what is your third question?
So diversification.
Yeah. So again, it depends on... you call an iPod and an iPad a diversification from Mac laptops? I mean, I'm just trying to understand your definition of
diversification. Say services, the products are being going on. They have separate service segment. They cater the Apple products.
We are into both product and service. That is very clear. Consulting as well.
Yeah, something like teaching. So you are saying that you are going to sell the product, teachers are going to take it in the school. Separately, whether you have ideas like open a kind of tuition centers or what you call conceptual learning centers for specific subjects, for specific grades?
See, we definitely have plans of tapping technology to expand. I don't know if it will mean the product goes through a main. The product as is where is will not fit in directly. So that's one major, diversification or expansion, as you may call it. In terms of establishing brick and mortar centers and all that, there are some thoughts, there are people who are interested in taking our philosophy, but that's not our priority. Our expansion in the next few years are going to come more from tapping technology, both in schools as well as direct to home. So the theme being better learning, the theme being holistic learning. For example, one of the biggest unique things about our curriculum or what we do in schools is effective emotional development of children, which is highly disregarded. You have various products that will tell you, I'll strengthen your mathematical concept, I will strengthen your physics concept, science concept, but no one product, at least as far as we know today, focuses equally through science, through math, in building a sensitive human being. So a sensitive, a logical, analytical mind, with emotional equanimity. These are our thing. And like I said, when I started, we focus on self-discovery. Today, how many of us, when we are in our 30s and 35, realize that I was not meant to be an engineer? I was not meant to be whatever. It's 99%, right? So we believe that the schooling can actually be a place where you discover yourself. So you will see that there are components in our curriculum that makes a child feel very proud about the fact that I'm a very good artist and maybe this is what I would like to do. Or I think theater excites me. And that doesn't mean I don't finish my schooling or my basic background, but always this is a regret that comes along, right? I wish somebody had told me that computer science is not. I was talking to a parent recently and he says, I thought I've seen 3 Idiots, blah, blah, and all, and I told my son he wanted to become a computer engineer because that's where the scope is. I wanted him to do architecture because I have a business, and he told me, no, don't force me, and I saw all these movies and all this yarn, and I said, I'm going to give him the freedom. Today he comes back and says, why didn't you force me to do architecture? So he's like, what is wrong with my parenting? So I said, this is because we have no possibility of children understanding their potential or whatever. It is just peer pressure, and you go back to your parent and say, you should have forced me, you know, that day. Now it's a waste of time for me to have done computer education. So parents have a very tough time. No? You think you're doing something good for your child and it turns out to be that the son is angry with you because... So,
that's what Western culture and Indian culture is different, I suppose, that they don't hold the parents responsible.
Absolutely. And it's more relevant today because we are also seeking an entrepreneurial climate in the country. See, he was talking about in America, it's so much more easier. If we had been in Silicon Valley, we would have had more opportunities. That's changing, I think, a bit.
Couple of questions. One more question.
So when you say that, what do you communicate to the parents? Because at the end, they are going to pay you for the product. So you would definitely have overcome some challenges in that. So how did you do that? So this is one question. One more thing is, when you say your product is, it has an impact on the students when they use it, when teachers come and say, so what is that one motivation factor which is there in your product?
So, first question was
the parent and you convinced.
So we do not invariably 99% of the time the parent is not in the picture until the decision is taken. Schools are still not so benevolent to say I want to have an inclusive decision taking. They decide and then they tell us now we have to send a fee circular, so you please talk to the parents. So it is not convincing them of the decision, it is more conveying and communicating the attributes of our product. So when I say we communicate to the parents, it is not just about the product. It is in the context of the product, we say this is what good education is all about. This is what your child should be actually learning in school. This is the kind of an environment your school is planning to give. So it's not so much about convincing the parent. It is about propagating certain myths in education. A myth, I would say, is that my child should write a lot.
Okay, so that definitely should have been difficult, right? Because they have a different understanding of what they have seen. They should have a different
perspective. So, to just sum it up, no, nothing in EZVidya is easy except the name. It's everyday struggle. It's everyday hard work. So, I say the only easy in EZVidya is EZVidya. So, it's very difficult. It's extremely difficult because you know, when we address a parent of say 100 parents, 200 parents, each one have their own problems, each one have their own philosophy about education. So, and who are you? You know, you have to really, so much of communication and consistent things that you have to reach out to. So, sometimes I wonder, you know, like somebody saw Indian traffic and said, only so many accidents, I mean, it's so chaotic. like that I look back and say, actually we're successful, how come? You know, it's that difficult. I would honestly say it's very difficult, but I think that's what challenges people like Ganesh and me and many others in the company. We want to be, we believe we are made of tougher metal, that we will take these challenges. It's not everybody does, right? There can be more highly profit making businesses, but we are looking at it holistically. And your second question was?
One more was, what is the motivation of that?
So, we have understood this learner very well. One simple example is, you've seen textbooks, right? Textbook is nothing but textbook full of text. And today's children, what do you think they miss most when they enter the classroom? They just miss the remote control. Right? Because every gadget, including the television, that the child interacts outside of the classroom, has him controlling it. I can change the channel. I can stop this game and go to another game. I can switch applications. In a class, 40 minutes, I have to face this bloody teacher. I don't know. I mean, I have to, even if I don't like what she's talking, I have no other choice. I look out the window, enjoying nature, and she said, why are you not listening to me? So he misses this. If we had that, he would control the class. We are trying to bring in elements in our curriculum where he feels in control. I mean, I won't do a product explanation here, but that is the secret. Today's learner, it is not like how we were in school. Today this guy cares to, you know, he doesn't care. What are you trying to tell me? I know this. We hear third standard, fourth standard children, the social studies teacher, Google told me something else. You know, you are competing with 300 channels and innumerable, you know, that search engine throws up. And what is this teacher? When I was in school, she was God. The geography I knew was what my geography teacher told me. If she said the earth is round, I believe the earth is round. Today he just goes to Google and tells her, no, you're wrong, whatever. So, bringing him in control, that is the singular approach that we are taking for that. And we are not fully tech, we are blended learning, we have books, we have materials for children. We have not gone all out on the tech overdose because, again, it's our responsibility. He has an overdose of tech to bring him back to nature. There is a nature deficiency syndrome today in children, do you know that? They do not get enough inputs of nature through their sense organs. You see children today in the train. How many children look out of the window and see the trees that they are passing by? And I see parents, just because he'll ask questions, what is that there? And they want to be messaging, it includes me. They want to be on the phone checking mails. They just throw an iPad to this child and say, oh, can't they, that's a game. I've seen that happening in Shatabdi and other trains that you go. And I feel like telling this father, just ask him to look out here of the window. I still love looking out of the window in a train. It's not often that you get that. So there is a nature deficiency syndrome among kids. So if a responsible educational company just throws to the 21st century learner more gadgets, it's doomsday. So we have to balance. At the same time, we don't want to lose him. You call me a nerd if I say now stop, looking at your gadgets, don't go to your iPads, listen to me. That's also not the way. So again, a middle ground. How do you attract them? How do you also expose them? So again, that's a very difficult thing. That's what the R&D is all about. How do you strike a balance? Very interesting though, with all the challenges on that.
So thanks a lot. Thank you so much for taking the time. It's been absolutely inspiring.
Thank you.
So they'll all join me in saying that this has been one of the best sessions we've had. Thank you so much for taking the time and inspiring us.
Thank you. I think I'm a very audience person, so I think all the questions and the body language, that's what inspired me to be very honest about whatever. And I think it's been really wonderful. So you can reach out to us if you have more specific questions about any possible. Since you're all budding entrepreneurs, many of you, definitely we can propel in this ecosystem, be it tech, be it anything to do with education, content, particularly tech, we are looking for partnering people, young entrepreneurs. So feel free to write to us and